All right, thanks everybody. I appreciate it so much for being here. I'm going to talk about a problem that many people face today, and that is that they aren't able to participate in the financial system. I'm going to define the financial system as not just banking, but it also includes investing. Other parts include credit, credit ratings, credit cards, systems of paying bills online. This is all part of the financial system. That's the whole infrastructure. And I want to make an assumption that most people can walk comfortably on a treadmill. So this is about 2 miles an hour. It's almost painfully slow, right? You guys can all walk 2 miles an hour, right? OK, good. So let's make an assumption that people are on a financial treadmill. Think about it from a less privileged family living paycheck to paycheck. So you're on stepping on this financial treadmill. At first, you're keeping pace just fine without breaking a sweat. But a few minutes later, something startles you, and your hours get cut at work. And the treadmill goes to level 3. You have to walk a little faster to keep up. At the end of the week, you come up short, and you have to make ends meet by skipping a bill. So the treadmill now goes to level 4. And by the way, 4 miles an hour is quite a bit faster. I did this on a treadmill at the gym, just so I knew what I was talking about here. It's a little bit faster to keep up. You got a power walk. And you're gonna power walk, because the last thing you want to do is be overdrawn in your checking account. So that bill you skipped only cost a few bucks. Not a big deal, but the unexpected doctor's visit leaves you with only $10 in the bank. And then your Netflix automatic payment kicks in. How much does Netflix cost? 12 bucks, right? So now you're negative 2, right? No, because what happens when you're overdrawn on your checking account? $35 overdraft fee. My bank charges $39. TCF Federal. Thanks a lot, guys. So you're now negative 41 or something like that. You might not even be aware of it for a few days. And then this makes your automatic cell phone bill that hits the next day not get paid, and another $39 bill, another $39 fee for that. And this could happen several times over. All of a sudden, you are at 140 bucks in the hole, you're in the negative, and that treadmill goes to level 5 or 6, and the incline goes up, and you're having to start to run to keep up. You're still able to hold your own, and of course you dump Netflix, but you can't dump your cell phone because you need it for work. And then all of a sudden you get a flat tire. That's about $200, and easily absorbed by most people in this room, not a problem. But for you, it's really rough. And that treadmill now goes to level 7. And I'm not gonna try to approximate level 7, I don't have enough room, I'd fall off the end of the stage. It's really fast, and your heart starts pumping, and things are getting really hot. I mean, literally hot, because it's also summertime. And you can't turn on the air conditioning, because then your electric bill is going to be too high. So you just suffer, and you start to sweat. Sweat's running down your spine, it's in your face, your legs start to burn. It's like you're running from a rabid dog, and you are. His name is Bankfee. Okay, that was a joke. Pretty lame, agree? Yeah. Funny name for a dog, but stick with me here. People see you struggling, but nobody helps. They're too busy trying to not fall off their own treadmill. Or what happens sometimes is people start driving by and saying, it's your own fault. You shouldn't have had a baby. Or you should have gone to school so you get a better job. Or ironically today, you shouldn't have gone to school to get that stupid degree. So these are things that you hear people say even though you're minding your own business and just trying to survive. I mean, you've got a second job. You're driving for Uber every spare minute. Oh, but except that cell phone bill that you got, that one that wasn't paid. So T-Mobile just canceled you. And the next bill that came in was your car insurance. So now you're not driving for Uber anymore. And you're completely underwater. All these little things could have been absorbed, but they just didn't happen. And you fall off the treadmill. You lose your balance. You're not driving for Uber. Your checking account gets closed, and now you're completely out of the system. So you've been running for years. You never got anywhere. And this is the reality for 30% of the population. 30% are underbanked or unbanked, living paycheck to paycheck. So here are the numbers. 7% of American households are unbanked. That's 9 million people. About 20% are underbanked. And that means they might have a checking account, but they use what's called fringe services. So that's check cashing places, payday loans. Prepaid debit cards are huge amongst the underbanked and the less fortunate. And it's $15 billion a year collected by banks in bank fees. So there are many reasons why people are unbanked or underbanked. Sometimes they just live too far away. They're in a rural area. They're old people. They have little access. Sometimes these banks they don't put branches in high crime areas. A lack of education, lack of literacy. This could be from the government schools. I don't know if you guys realize this. They don't teach finances in government school systems. They kind of start to talk about it, but they really don't go very deep. Maybe you're illiterate. English is your second language. A big thing is this lack of trust. You know, banks hand you a 37-page document with all the fine print on 10-point font, and the bank fees are listed on page 17. And sometimes these bank fees are as simple as checking your account balance at an ATM charges you $2 that you didn't know about, and that just brings that down more and more. And these fees start to stack up on each other. So when you go to an ATM that's not your bank ATM and you withdraw $20, what does that cost? The bank charges you usually $250 to $350. The ATM operator charges you $250. I can't tell you how many times I've seen people go to a no-name ATM, put their card in, and pull out $20, and that costs them 25% or more. It costs them $5 to get 20. And these things pile up on people, and they suddenly just don't trust banks. They don't understand all these high fees, and why bother? So bad credit, divorce, student loans. Sometimes people go to jail, and their finances go to crap. I mean, marijuana charges, in this state, thankfully, people are not going to jail for that anymore, but nonviolent people are going to jail and their finances are ruined. People are homeless sometimes, or maybe they're in transition. They've got mental health issues. So people in these categories use cash and cash only because they don't fit into the financial system. They don't have a bank account. So renting a car, paying bills online, getting a hotel room, shopping online, none of these things are available to a lot of these people. They can't drive for Uber or Lyft. These are privileges that most of us take for granted, and they pay more than you do in fees, and they get less, and they can't get ahead because the system won't let them. So let me just talk about the system here, the financial system. I know there's no evil banker in the back room twirling his mustache and going, how do I screw the poor over? And I know, I'll charge more bank fees. So banks have a lot of expenses. They can't service everyone, and lower economic people are more expensive for them to service. I mean, I get that. There's banking transactions are expensive without blockchains. There's fraud, chargebacks, expensive branches to man and to maintain, and keeping up with the technology. There's employees to take care of. They have to work within a ton of very expensive regulations. There aren't a lot of economic incentives for banks to service everybody. I understand that. Not having a bank account means bad or no credit, which keeps people from working their way up the ladder. This also means that they can't get home loans and car loans, so they stay in this negative perpetual cycle. They don't have access to 401ks. They don't have access to IRAs, 529 plans, HSAs, other vehicles that a lot of us take for granted. Investment laws only let accredited investors invest in IPOs and ICOs. That's going to come down. We all understand this. ICOs will be out of reach in America unless you're a millionaire. So if a person in a lower economic class has any money that they may have saved up that they can invest with, what are their options? What are they legally allowed to invest in? Besides my team, do you have any ideas what they're allowed to invest in? Lottery. Woohoo! The poor are left to play the lottery, which has the worst returns of any investment. It's got the worst returns of any Vegas game, in fact. So think about that. A lot of regulators, there are some at this conference, I'm sure, they're probably thinking that they're protecting the poor from themselves, that they are too uneducated to make decisions. They don't want this poor family to invest their last $500 on some ICO. Only savvy investors are allowed to do that. They can be trusted with their own money, but not the poor. But hey, check out that Powerball jackpot, right? You can pay in cash too. So this is a really cool quote I wanted to share with you. I found this. This is from the National Financial Education Center. I'm just going to read it. Investing in the stock market has to do with risk. Buying a lottery ticket has to do with chance. Chance is not the same as risk. You may be able to increase your chances, but you can never impact it. The odds are always the same. But when you have the ability to make a choice, you can have a significant impact on the outcome of a risky situation. And investing could be considered a risky situation, but you can impact that. You can choose the timing of when you buy. You can choose the amount that you buy. You can choose the kind of stock or cryptocurrency or ICO that you can buy. You can choose the timing of when you get out of the market, or when you cash out, so to speak. And every single choice that you make, which you can improve on with experience and education, has a direct impact on how much your investments will grow or shrink. But by not allowing poor people the ability to make mistakes, and more importantly, to learn from their mistakes, we keep them infantilized. They can't reap the rewards, they don't learn to control the risk, and then they quite literally never learn. And that means they can never pass on what they've learned to their children. We have generationally people stuck in this cycle. So it'd be interesting to see how well the S&P 500 has done as far as returns go compared to somebody buying a lottery ticket twice a week for 18 years. So here it is. The orange line is what you would have earned over 18 years if you invested $4 a week, it's two lottery tickets a week at $2 each, 1% return, you get about $4,000. Stock market is the blue line. If you reinvested all of the dividends, you would be at $7,500 at $4 a week after 18 years. Two lottery tickets a week is the green line. You would be negative $3,300, and that's including the likely winnings, the statistical winnings. Maybe win $100 and you see a little blip up there, woohoo! And it triggers your gambler's, the dopamine, the gambler's high, perhaps, right? And then you buy more. I would rather have them, instead of taking a chance on the lottery ticket, you can still keep that gambler's high, but let's let them manage the risk in a stock market situation. Like politically run lotteries, cryptocurrencies and CGEs, it's a coin generation event, allows anybody to invest very small amounts of money, $2, $4. You know, they can do that with these new cryptocurrencies. And suddenly the poor can own an asset just like rich people can. It's like having a piece of a startup, part of a network, something that might become big, something they can manage the risk of instead of taking a chance on. And they may have some decent returns. They may lose some or all of their hard-earned money also, I understand. But they will learn from their mistakes. It's not going to happen with a lottery ticket. And managing the small amounts of money, managing the risk, they would still gain wisdom and knowledge that they could pass on to their kids and possibly break these cycles. And finally, they could have something bigger to believe in. Or, woohoo! Believe in something bigger. Do you see any SEC forward-looking statements? It's kind of sad in some ways. So remember the treadmill example from earlier? There was a time recently where I had the wind knocked out of me and I fell off the treadmill. I wasn't living paycheck to paycheck, luckily, but I didn't see this coming, and this was out of the blue, and it's a true story. 2017, last year, I just came back from Anarcopulco, which is an Acapulco conference for anarchists, rebels, revolutionaries, people who want to change the system, and I was all excited about changing the system also. One morning after the conference, I woke up and literally couldn't poop. Sorry, I know it's almost lunchtime. So the only symptom was that. So I went to urgent care, and the doctor said, your appendix is going to pop. Let's get you to the emergency room. That's what we think it is. And after x-rays and CAT scans and MRIs, they found a baseball-sized tumor growing in my gut. And here's a picture of it. It's not my tumor, but I was diagnosed with a Burkitt lymphoma. It's an aggressive and very rare form of cancer. It affects 300 people a year in the US. It's much more common among African children, boys typically. The incidence peaks at ages 5 to 8. It is known as having the fastest growing tumor of any known cancer in the world. So there I was, 50 years old, living in Edina, Minnesota. I had never been to Africa, I was nowhere near the equator. Why the hell did I get Burkitt lymphoma? So one reason is because I'm a rebel, right? My friend Mark, where's Mark? He always likes to say, why did you have to get the rebellious form of cancer? Why couldn't you get like a normal kind of cancer? No, you had to get the fastest growing tumor and you know the one that's the rarest. Ugh. So it's crazy, but I had just started working on what would become Vault Logic at the time. And all of a sudden I find myself in the hospital. So I wasn't going to let that stop me. Things weren't easy. So this next picture disturbs me a little bit, but I was in the hospital for 3 months. I was on the couch for an additional month after that. I lost all my hair and lost 30 pounds, and I don't have 30 pounds to lose. This is what I look like when I'll be 70, maybe 75. Despite having the fastest growing tumor of all known cancers, that means it sucks up the chemo the fastest, and it's one of the most curable forms of cancer too. 85% cure rate. I formed Vault Logic from my hospital bed, literally. I was on the bed being wheeled down to one of my 7 spinal taps, having a video conference with Sarah Blinko and John Owens. It was fun until the chemo really kicked in, but so I formed Vault Logic from my hospital bed, then from my mom's couch eventually, then from my own couch when I got a little bit better. And I'm happy to report that 1 year later to this week, I am completely cancer-free. Thanks. Yeah. So yeah, and just mentally send that good energy to the nurses in the world. How many people are nurses or have nurses in their families? Anybody? Yeah, yeah. I have such an appreciation for nurses right now. I cannot tell you. So, I tell you the story because it really humbled me more than I could imagine. So, I was fortunate that I had a job with health insurance. I had a stable family, friends who were financially stable. I could take care of this. It was not going to be a huge thing for me. But I couldn't stop thinking about the millions of people who don't have that ability, don't have this, aren't in the financial system. They have few, if any, resources to keep them off of the political trap of welfare aid. So our idea of forming Vault Logic as another Bitcoin ATM machine kind of changed to creating a network on a familiar platform that could help the underserved. And that stable, familiar, easy to understand, and trusted platform is called Cash. You thought I was going to say blockchain, didn't you? No, Cash. So what does that have to do with the blockchain? Well, in some ways, Cash is like a token. Here's one. This token represents $5. It's got an agreed upon value. It's a politically controlled token. It's printed out of thin air by decree, but represents agreed upon value. It's fungible. You can mix them together and any one is not different from the other ones. It's easy to transport. I can put it in my pocket. It's fairly durable. In fact, if you have a bank account, you can digitize this. Put it in the bank account. It becomes digitized. It's tracked on a shared ledger, not a public ledger, a private bank control ledger. It's not immutable, but still, it can be digitized and sent across the country in minutes using something like PayPal. So instead of somehow getting the poor into this financial system, we at Vault Logic wanted to bridge the gap by using blockchains to let people stay out of that financial system and use the familiar cash rails that they already understand and trust. Maybe if that was available, more of us would get out of the system, actually. It's kind of a funny thing to think about. Instead of 30%, let's get that to 40%, and then 50%. There are two markets in this country, really. There is the one that uses the bank rails, the financial system, and then there's one that uses the cash rails. And the cash rail, like I said, is 30% of the population. So another gap that we're bridging is bringing these economies together. So we're giving the cash economy people access to similar services that the other group already enjoys. And in some ways, vice versa. 30% is a big chunk of a financial pie that big companies would like to service if there was a cash rail that they could meet them at. And we're providing them with our ATM. How many people have seen our ATM downstairs? Almost everybody? Okay, good. Those of you who haven't, I invite you to come check it out. Folks on that treadmill to nowhere living, driving from payday loans to Walmart to send money to their friends or family, to the check cashing store, to the Sprint store, then to pay their electric bill, all in cash. They have to drive around to all these different locations. And for all those people who lose so much of their money to bank fees, those days are over. So not only does it make no sense with the technology we have in 2018, it's not right either. And blockchain can empower people who have never even heard of it. So how much more could they accomplish? How much healthier would they be with the reduced stress? How much more time would they have instead of driving to four places to pay their bills? What could they do with that extra time? What could they do with the extra cash? So instead of bridging or bringing these people into the banking system, we're going to meet them where they are. We're going to get them off the treadmill to nowhere to an open playing field of opportunity. And they can still use their cash for services and bills from a single convenient location. But when they're ready to, when they have a little extra money, the cryptocurrency ability is right there at the same ATM. And maybe they would buy some cryptocurrency for a little while, like a month or a week, and they can manage that risk and then sell back out again. And they start to learn about markets. They don't need a credit card for this. They won't need a bank account. Their cash is the key to get them into this new economy. What if there's a network of machines that allowed low-income people to keep using the cash networks they're familiar with and to be introduced and get incentives even from this network? It would look like a familiar machine, except it would be much more multifaceted. Some of our partners who developed the hardware were thinking ATM machines have these complex cash systems inside. It's got an internet connection. It moves the cash in and out. And it does one thing, only one thing. So this machine does many things. So here are some of the benefits for the unbanked and the consumers. They can pay bills with cash. They can buy cell phone minutes with cash. It could be a low fee or even in some circumstances a no fee ATM. And I can explain how that works if you come visit us at our booth down there. Maybe you would even get rebates from pulling money out of the ATM. So you pull out $100, you get $105 because the machine self-balances. So those are some of the potential rewards that people could get for being part of our network and helping us balance the cash. And when they're ready, they have easy access to Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies. So just to make it clear, we are not providing bill pay services. We do not provide check cashing services. We do not provide ATM services. Vault Logic is hardly providing cryptocurrency services. These are all APIs that can be exposed by third parties who want to use this platform, this cash network that we've created. And the benefits for businesses are, it's quite a compelling use case also. So the idea is cash as a service. This is a bankless cash network. It makes it more efficient. Little to no maintenance. Cash handling is reduced down to like 80% of what it was. The machine has built-in counterfeit detection. It actually tracks the serial number. So in law enforcement, if they ever had a suspicion that there was, if our machine actually detected sequential serial numbers, we would put out a SAR, which is a, what does it stand for again? Suspicious activity report, right, exactly. And if there's an investigation, law enforcement could come to us and we could see their subpoena, and yes, here is the information, and here's the camera, and here's the picture of the person who put in sequential bills. AML, KYC flows are all customizable, but here's the cool thing. New income streams. ATM businesses are kind of a dying business right now because of the cash handling fees. So they can get new income streams from bill pay, cell phone minutes, aforementioned ATM services that they're already part of. Check cashing is a possibility with the right money service business. And then we introduce them to ICOs and coin generation events. Plus, there's a big advertising stream. So that's another revenue. These are plug-in apps. We can support all kinds of crypto vending software. This is actually the interface of our ATM downstairs. As you can see, if you can click on send money, these are all third-party services. People can send money to Mexico, all these different countries. In fact, Western Union could expose their APIs through this machine. Go to mobile prepaid. Mobile prepaid is cell phone top-up minutes. Now, you may think the poor wouldn't have a smartphone. Yes, they do. Almost all poor people have smartphones. There was the Obama phone situation where they got a lot of free, simple smartphones. They have these phones, and they get minutes. They can't get an account with T-Mobile, but they buy top-up minutes. And that's an unregulated process, so that's very easy to expose anywhere to any one of these carriers. Go down to pay bills for me. Here are the different bill pay. And these are actual bill pay customers that our partner, Mayatech, is already exposing in 25 of their machines that are already out in the wild right now. Gift cards is another possibility. And even international prepaid gift cards. So a worker in California can pay his mom's cell phone bill in Mexico. This sort of thing. Now, if you click on the crypto option at the top there, again, we just expose third parties' APIs. Capital Hero is a, if you click on that one, Capital Hero is a crypto vending API. And downstairs right now, you can actually buy Bitcoin, Litecoin, Dash, Bitcoin Cash. And our next iteration, you'll be able to buy and sell. So it's a pretty amazing little machine. And there is just no reason in these days and age that these complex machines can do only one thing. So there's a lot of revenue possibilities. It's a lot of way to help people take care of themselves. And it's a great way to introduce a lot of new people to the Bitcoin and the blockchain space.